Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. At question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This week marked the start of Ramadan for Scotland's Muslim community, and I'm sure the whole chamber will join me in wishing everyone observing Ramadan peace and happiness. For years, drug deaths have been Scotland's national shame. This week it emerged that drug deaths have risen again, up 10% on the previous year. Hamza Yousaf's new Minister for Drugs, Christina McKelvey, was asked for her response. She said, "The plan is working." Surely the First Minister can't agree with that.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, can I also wish Muslims here in Scotland, across the UK and right across the world, a happy Ramadan, though my thoughts are often with those in Muslim communities who are fasting or cannot access food or water, not out of choice because of their fasting for Ramadan, but because of poverty or indeed conflict. Presiding Officer, in terms of the drugs deaths, let me say first and foremost that my condolences and the condolences of the entire government are with every single person that has lost a loved one to suspected drugs deaths. But we know, of course, from engaging with those families, it's not warm words, it's not words of sympathies or condolence they want. It is action, and I am devastated to see that rise, particularly as, of course, we saw and witnessed some progress in the year before with a reduction in suspected drugs deaths. This is a deep-rooted endemic problem in our society, and what I would say to Douglas Ross is that we are taking a range of significant actions to try to tackle this insidious problem in our society. We're absolutely committed. We have an unwavering, unshakable commitment to the national mission to tackle drugs death, and that's why we've continued to expand residential rehab, and I can give some more detail of that in subsequent answers. We've provided £50 million a year to community and grassroots organisations that are helping those in their local areas suffering with substance abuse and addiction. We've progressed work with local authorities like Glasgow on safer consumption rooms. We've continued to roll out the carriage of naloxone and drive up the MAT standards, as well as a range of other actions. And what we'll continue to do is make sure that we maintain the drugs budget as well for 24-25. So this rise is deeply disheartening, this rise in suspected drug deaths, deeply disheartening. But what it will only serve to do from a government's perspective is ensure that we continue to rededicate ourselves and recommit ourselves to tackling one of the most insidious challenges and problems that we face in our society.
Douglas Ross.
The First Minister referenced last year's figures, and at the time, the former Drugs Minister said in August last year that the government was turning the tide on the drug deaths crisis. We now hear from the current Drugs Minister that even with a 10% increase, she believes the plan is working. It is absolutely not. Drug deaths in Scotland have consistently been the highest across Europe, and they're on the rise again. The SNP plan is not working, and they seem to be repeating the same mistakes all over again. Nicola Sturgeon let a rehab facility in her own constituency close in 2019. Now Hamza Yousaf has let Turning Point 218, a vital rehab service for women in Glasgow, close. The head of justice at Turning Point Scotland said this: "The loss of this service is likely to lead to more women in custody and trapped within the justice system." And the First Minister himself said in this chamber, just in January, that it does excellent work. He continued, "I value the project very highly." Just a few weeks later, it closed. So why did this happen?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, can I just give an absolute confirmation that the Drugs Minister, Christina McKelvey, and I, during our visit to the Bothian Excellent Community Project based in Craigmillar, Minister for Alcohol and Drugs Policy absolutely believes, as I do, that we have to rededicate ourselves and take further action because we know, of course, that rise is unwelcome. And Douglas Ross is right to say that our numbers of suspected drug deaths per head of the population is higher than other parts of the UK. Other parts of the UK have also seen a rise, and I suspect part of that is because of the tide that we are up against. That is, of course, seeing more potent, stronger, more addictive substances on our streets, such as synthetic opioids, nitazines, and so on and so forth. There is absolutely no complacency about the action that we have to take. In relation to 218, Presiding Officer, it's an important issue that is raised. It should be said that was a council decision, not our decision, of course. The only decision that we made from a Scottish Government perspective was when Glasgow City Council asked whether or not they could retain the £1.5 million funding for re-tendering to another service. We said that we would allow them to retain that money, to be able to use it flexibly. It would also not be correct to say that there aren't facilities for women in particular that are facing substance abuse in Glasgow. There's a whole range, and I'm happy to release the letter that we received from the Health and Social Care Partnership. We have Tomorrow Women's Group, a community-based service for women involved in the justice system. We have the Glasgow Drugs Court, which we know operates a women's only clinic a day a week. We have Glasgow has 59 purchased residential placements that are both for men and women in alcohol and drug recovery services. There are 60 tenancy sustained placements specifically open to those in justice social
briefly,
work.
First Minister.
A gender-specific community support service. And there are other services which I'm happy to talk to and further answer. So what I would say is we continue to provide record funding this year to alcohol and drugs partnerships. We'll continue to take actions with our local authorities. And of course, I'm happy to continue to work cross-party, as my predecessor did, work cross-party, in order that we all collectively work together to tackle what is one of the most challenging issues our society faces.
Douglas Ross.
The First Minister wants to dodge responsibility for the closure of this vital service that has served women in Glasgow for two decades. So let's just listen to what the Unite Regional Officer Linda Wilson said. This is her words. It's utterly shameful that both Glasgow City Council and the Scottish Government believe the best way to help vulnerable women is to cut beds and slash the funding of a lifeline service. A newspaper reports today include emails that suggest the government was aware that Turning Point would be closed but didn't step in to prevent it. Unite say it was crystal clear that the Scottish Government was central to the decision-making process which led to the 218 service closing. Hamza Youssef is trying to avoid responsibility. He's using the same excuses as Nicola Sturgeon. So why are the SNP making the same mistakes all over again?
First Minister.
Well, let me try to, of course, eject also some of the facts into this discussion, Presiding Officer. We are not cutting beds. Under the Scottish Government, we've invested £38 million in expanding capacity in residential rehab as part of the national mission. We, of course, have 32 of these beds are operational. We have another 38 in the pipeline just over the next few months. And with the projected funding that we have, we believe we're absolutely on track to meet our commitment on increasing overall residential rehab capacity from 425 to 650 by 2026. We're also very much on target in relation to the targets that we've set ourselves for publicly funded rehab placements. So the suggestion, as Douglas Ross made it, that we're cutting residential rehab beds is simply not true. In terms of the decision that was made by Glasgow City Council in 218, again, I'm happy to release these letters if they have not been released already. If I go back to what one of our officials or civil servants wrote to Glasgow City Council, and I'll quote directly from the letter, Presiding Officer, we consider that any decision to re-tender the service, that's the 218 service, is entirely a matter for Glasgow City Council, but can confirm we have no objection to the replacement service utilising the funding currently allocated to the 218 service. So we, of course, did the right thing by ensuring that funding was flexible for the local authority. And what we now see, of course, that in Glasgow City Council, there are a range of initiatives that are still available for women to be able to access, whether that's, for example, Delilius Community Custody Centres based in Glasgow, and practices evolved greatly in supporting all women currently serving sentences in the establishment, or whether it's Glasgow Women Aid, Hymet Greif, Glasgow East Women's Aid, they can provide up to 64 safe places for women, and SAY women who support women 16 to 25 have 9 spaces in purposely built flats as well. So there's a range of initiatives. I'm
briefly,
happy to write to
First
Douglas
Minister.
Ross with detail of how we're supporting Glasgow City Council and other local authorities in ensuring that they increase residential rehab, not decrease it.
Douglas Ross.
I don't know how the First Minister can possibly stand there and say he is supporting people who are struggling when a facility has closed after 20 years of supporting vulnerable women. And the government were involved. Emails that were published in the newspaper article today said that the tendering of 218 was with relevant ministers for a view. And that another email...
Members, let's hear Mr Ross.
Another email referred to the likelihood of needing ministerial clearance for any new approach. That's in the emails that have been published today. And during the SNP leadership contest, Hamza Yousaf said, if there's more money we can give to alcohol and drugs in particular, then that's going to be a priority focus for me. Well, it's clear it's not a priority. Nicola Sturgeon cut funding for drug treatment in 2015 and drug deaths rose. This year, Hamza Yousaf has cut the treatment budget in real terms. They promised to create hundreds of new rehab beds, but they've managed just over 30. The addiction crisis in Scotland is out of control. Since the SNP came to power, drug deaths have doubled. They are the worst in Europe, and new figures show deaths are increasing again. Scotland's shame has not gone away. Nicola Sturgeon admitted she took her eye off the ball. Hasn't Hamza Yousaf done exactly the same?
First Minister.
No, Presiding Officer, I reject that in its entirety. Let's try to take some of the issues that Douglas Ross mentioned in his question. The drugs budget, of course, we have increased over the years. The increase of funding into drugs policy that we have presided over the last, for example, if I take 2014-15 to 23-24, that's a 67% increase in funding. That's by Audit Scotland figures that were recently published. The draft budget for 24-25 has maintained our budget for alcohol and drugs at the same level this year. And of course, this year, we've seen record funding, £113 million, into alcohol and drugs partnerships. Douglas Ross references if there was more money. The point is, of course, we've had a £500 million real terms cut to our budget by the UK government. Yeah. If, of course, Douglas Ross is able to convince his colleagues south of the border to give further funding to Scotland, then I absolutely promise him that
drugs and alcohol policy
will be one of the areas that we look to give further funding to. In terms of the action that we are taking, again, I'm happy to write to Douglas Ross with more detail. We have, of course, ensured that there's greater carriage of naloxone, over 150,000 kits. We are working with Greater Glasgow and Glasgow City Council on more radical approaches, such as a safe consumption room. We are increasing numbers of beds in terms of residential rehab, and as I say, continue to work with local authorities to help tackle this issue. I make that offer that I've made already to Douglas Ross, to others right across the chamber, that we are willing to work cross-party in order to resolve what is one of the most difficult challenges this country has faced, and an issue that has plagued our society, not just for years, Presiding Officer, but for decades.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I join others in wishing Muslims here and around the world Ramadan Mubarak? It's a month of fasting from sunrise to sunset, a month of reflection, thinking of those that are less fortunate, and a month of charity, and our thoughts are with all those living in poverty and in conflict at this time. I must say I'll have to battle dry mouth for 10 minutes. Fair play to the First Minister, who has to do it for 45 minutes this afternoon. Presiding Officer, it's been 4.5 years since the SNP government declared a drugs death emergency. Since then, over 5,200 lives have been lost in drug-related deaths. Every single one of them, someone's son, daughter or loved one. In 2023 alone, 1,197 people died, a 10% increase on the previous year. And the response from the drugs minister this week was, the plan is working. But this is what Anne-Marie Ward, the CEO of Favour UK, said. They have the audacity to claim progress in this catastrophe. Their assertions are a slap in the face, a mockery of the grim reality we witness daily. How dare they feed us these blatant lies, expecting us to nod along while our communities are ravaged and our streets are lined with the casualties of their incompetence? Who is right? Are people impacted by drugs or the drugs minister?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, this government continues to engage with those who have lived experience and are on their recovery journey. The drugs minister and I did that just this week, just yesterday. We met with those with lived experience, those who are going through the recovery journey, not to spin, as has been suggested, but to directly front up what is an extremely challenging issue and to say that we continue not just to listen, but to act. And that's what I say to Anna Sarwar and to Douglas Ross, that nobody in the government, neither myself, nor the Minister for Alcohol, Drugs and Alcohol policy. Nobody in this government is neither complacent nor at all attempting to dismiss the very serious concerns that have been raised by Douglas Ross, Anna Sawar, by parliamentarians across this chamber and indeed by our stakeholders. But I can point to the fact that we are taking action. We are, for example, continuing to expand residential rehab. We are providing funding to community-based organisations. We are working with the likes of Glasgow City Council on more radical approaches like safer drug consumption facilities. So we're not just doing the same thing. We're looking to see what more we can possibly do that's different. We're widening the access to naloxone. We're driving the MAT standards. Everybody knows how important same-day access to treatment is and can be. We're working on the rights of those who have lived experience through the National Collaborative. If there are particular interventions that Anna Sawar and others want us to explore and examine, I give him an absolute promise that we do so with an open mind. But nobody in government, but nobody, not me nor the Drugs Minister, are downplaying what is one of the most serious issues our country is facing.
Anna Sawar.
Training officer, is repeated action of this government where we focus a lot on the inputs but we don't actually look at the outcomes of government policy? Because what matters here is the outcomes. And the outcome is more people losing their lives to drugs. In Tayside, 83 people died last year. In Edinburgh, it was more than two a week. And in Glasgow, it was six people a week. In January 2021, the government set out targets to increase residential rehab beds. They promised 225 more beds by 2026. 3 years on, only 32 are operational. In 2022, the government said it would establish drug checking facilities, but 2 years on, no facilities are open and not a single licence application has been made. In what world does the First Minister think this plan is working, and how can he expect families who have lost loved ones to believe him when there doesn't seem to be any sense of urgency?
First Minister.
I reject the accusation that there isn't a sense of urgency. There absolutely is a sense of urgency. Anna Sawar started his question by asking what the outputs were. And he's absolutely right, outputs are important. There is an increase in residential rehab beds, and I'll come back to the very specific point that Anna Sawar made just shortly. The outputs of our actions mean that we have now better standards, I would say more urgent standards when it comes to access to treatment. The outcomes are that we now have over 150,000 naloxone kits that have been distributed, and indeed we know from Police Scotland figures that they've been used, naloxone has been used around about 500 times, which undoubtedly has in itself saved lives. That's an outcome and an output. In terms of course checking facilities for drugs, and my understanding is that they require a Home Office licence, and that's why we continue to work with Glasgow City Council and indeed engage with the UK Government in this regard. In relation to the point that Anna Sawar makes, we are on track to meet our targets in relation to increased capacity of residential rehab. The investment that we've made is in eight capacity projects that will provide an additional 172 beds by 2025-26, and the further funding that we will provide in 2025-26. We're very confident of meeting that 650 target by the end of the parliamentary term. I can give a breakdown in detail in writing if Anna Sawar wishes of the investments that we've made in residential rehab, but we are confident of not just meeting that target and output, but also the output on having 1,000 publicly funded rehab placements by, again, the end of the parliament.
Anna Sawar.
Sorry, officer, the outcome that matters is that drugs deaths should be falling, not increasing. That's the outcome that really matters here. Because despite everything that the First Minister has said, we have the exact same drug laws as everywhere else in the UK, but almost three times as many drugs deaths here in Scotland. The outcome we need this government to deliver is fewer people dying from drugs, not more and more people dying every year. Because it's been 4.5 years since the SNP government declared a drugs death emergency. 3 years since the launch of their national mission to reduce drug deaths, and almost 2 years since the final report of the Drugs Death Task Force. But yet, in the last year, 1,197 more people have died. Incompetence has consequences. It means Scotland has the highest rate of drugs death in Europe. And across Scotland, families are grieving loved ones whose deaths were preventable. But this government has failed on every promise it has made. Promises to increase rehab beds falling behind. Promises on drug checking facilities not delivered. Promises on new treatment standards broken. But all we've heard today are more of those exact same promises that aren't being delivered and about a plan that is not working. Drugs deaths are going up, not coming down. So I'll give him one last chance. What will he change to get a grip of this crisis and help save lives in Scotland?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, we know that there are many parts of the world, and of course right across the UK in particular, where there are challenges with synthetic opioids, nitazenes, fentanyl, and so on and so forth, which are more addictive, more potent, and therefore causing real harm and real concern right across the United Kingdom. That's why Anna Sarwar and Douglas Ross were both right to say that levels of drug deaths in Scotland are unacceptable and per head of the population higher than other parts of the UK. But we have, of course, seen increases in England and Wales, and I suspect it's largely down to the same issues that we're facing collectively, that we're seeing more addictive substances on our streets, such as synthetic opioids. I do say once again to Anna Sarwar that not only are we taking action, he says promises have been broken around increasing residential rehab. They aren't. I'm giving Anna Sarwar the evidence, the detail, the facts that the levels, the numbers of residential rehab beds have increased, and we are on track to meet our commitment towards the end of the Parliament. The same for publicly funded rehab places as well. And I can give an absolute guarantee, a promise to not just those in the Chamber, but those that are listening, that where we can try innovative approaches, new approaches, then we will absolutely seek to do that. That's why we're supporting Glasgow with funding for the Safer Consumption Room. It's why we're supportive of checking facilities for drugs and other interventions as well. And if we did have the power over the Misuse of Drugs Act, for example, we would seek to make changes in relation to the decriminalisation of drugs for personal use. And we've explored that issue because we know that intervention has worked in other countries. So I end, Presiding Officer, where I started. This government, of course, acknowledges the scale of the problem, the scale of the challenges, and rededicates itself to taking further action where we can, invest where we can, and work with anybody we possibly can to tackle this shameful and serious problem in our society.
Question number three, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the current 40 Days for Life protests.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government believes that patients and staff should be able to access abortion services free from intimidation, free from harassment, and free from undue influence. That's why we've committed to fully supporting the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill that Gillian Mackay has introduced to the Parliament. As Gillian Mackay will be more acutely aware than anyone, the bill is currently being scrutinised by the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, and I extend my thanks to Gillian Mackay for introducing the bill and to all the witnesses who have provided evidence to the committee thus far. So we'll continue to support the bill as it makes its way through the parliamentary process, and I'm hopeful its protection will soon be felt by women right across Scotland.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. Around the world in recent years, we've seen reproductive rights go backwards in countries such as the US, Poland and Brazil. But there are glimmers of hope, with rights expanding in Argentina and Colombia and the rights in abortion being enshrined in the Constitution in France. Does the First Minister agree with me that safe access zones must be the first stop on advancing rights here in Scotland? And does he believe that we should go further, including progressing providing abortion in Scotland up to the legal limit, ensuring equitable access to IVF and removing abortion from criminal law?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, first and foremost, I want to be clear that provisions and regulations of NHS abortion services within specified term limits should absolutely be a clinical matter and not a criminal one, and I'm happy to look at that issue in further details. I know there are nuances and complexities in looking into that issue, opening up that issue, which again I'm happy to discuss with the member in due course. There have of course been improvements in the provision of later stage abortions within Scotland, with all mainland boards now providing abortion to at least 20 weeks gestation. But Gillian Mackay is right to push the government and health boards to see what can be done even further in terms of later term abortions. And I'm happy to ensure the Health Secretary writes to her with further details of the actions that we are taking alongside health boards in this regard. That once the bill has made its way through Parliament, Gillian Mackay's bill, that we will begin a review of abortion law, which will focus on identifying potential proposals for reform.
John Mason.
Thank you. Would the First Minister not accept that no one is being harassed at these vigils or protests? No one is being intimidated. It is largely a small group of elderly, religious people standing at these facilities. And does he not think that we are slightly overreacting with legislation on this?
First Minister.
Look, I wouldn't agree with John Mason on that, I'm afraid. I think what's so important in this matter, particularly I have to say for men, is to listen to the voices of women. And women tell us and have given very powerful evidence and testimony that whatever John Mason's view may be, that they feel that harm is being done. They do feel harassed. They do feel intimidation. Now, even if John Mason was to, for whatever reason, discard that evidence, and I would encourage him not to, he should also listen to the clinicians at the services, the likes of Dr. Gregor Irwin and many others, who have spoken very powerfully about the impact it's also having on staff. Now, John Mason knows that I'm a religious person myself. I pray. But where you choose to pray, you can pray anywhere in the world for whatever you want. Why you have to go to an abortion service where women feel then harassed and intimidated, I have to say I do not understand. And therefore, I believe that legislation that Gillian Mackay is bringing forward is one that should have the support of this whole Parliament. We will certainly be supporting it from the Scottish Government. And I would say once again to John Mason, it's so crucial that as opposed to men perhaps imposing their view on what the impacts or effects on protests are to women, that John Mason would do well to listen to the voices of women and clinicians and staff at abortion services.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. These protesters are intimidating for women at what is undoubtedly a challenging moment in their lives. Given the waiting list pressures across the NHS, can I confirm if he has had direct discussions with health boards to ensure women can continue to access abortion services in a safe but, of course, a timely manner to avoid adding further anxiety to what is already a challenging time in their lives?
First Minister.
Carol Mockin is absolutely right to raise this issue, and we don't want anybody waiting longer than they have to for accessing healthcare. Particularly, we know over a range of issues that affect women in particular, the wait is far too long. In relation to the discussions that have been had between the government and health boards on a range of issues affecting abortion, access to abortion services, and perhaps some of the issues that were raised by Gillian Mackay, which Carol Mockin might have an interest in terms of later term abortion, I'm more than happy for the Health Secretary to write a detailed note to Carol Mockin, but she's absolutely right to raise the issues that she does, because nobody, and particularly women accessing health services, shouldn't have to wait a minute longer than I'm afraid they currently do.
Question number 4 has been withdrawn. Question number 5, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government will take in response to reported statistics showing that nearly 1 in 5 probationary teachers left the teacher induction scheme in 2023.
First Minister.
The teacher induction scheme is an important element of teacher education. It guarantees every eligible student teacher a 1-year probation placement to allow them to meet the standard for full registration. Probation numbers do fluctuate throughout the year due to deferrals, due to withdrawals, and this can be for a variety of reasons, including medical or indeed personal reasons, or extensions to the original initial teacher education qualification. The Strategic Board for Teacher Education, which is made up of a range of key education stakeholders, is looking at issues around teacher recruitment, increasing support for early career teachers, and also raising the profile of teaching as a valued profession.
Jamie Green.
I agree that it does fluctuate, but before COVID, the dropout rate was 13%. Last year, it was near 19%. So it is an alarming rise, First Minister. EIS believe that what is happening is that once teachers enter the workplace, they are just facing the harsh realities that many in the profession have known for some time. Increased workload, less support for teachers and pupils, and, of course, a lack of permanent secure jobs for many probationary teachers. Of course, on top of that is rising violence and abuse towards teachers, something which I think concerns all of us. We already know that since the First Minister's own party took office, there are 1,000 fewer teachers in Scotland's classrooms. And we know the direct impact that has on both subject choice and class sizes themselves. So my question is this, First Minister, why does he personally think that so many probation teachers are dropping out of the profession so early in their career? But more importantly, what is his government doing about it?
First Minister.
Thanks. Jamie Green is, of course, right to raise what is an important issue, one that will have cross-party interest. I think many of the reasons that Jamie Green gives for some of the reasons that we might see deferrals or indeed withdrawals from teaching are absolutely right. And the issues around violence in schools is an issue in particular that is high in our mind and high in the mind of the teaching profession. And again, I'm happy for the Education Secretary to write to Jamie Green with details of the actions that we're taking from, of course, the summits that have taken place, the guidance and the guidelines that we've provided schools and the support that we're providing in tackling that particular issue. That we are also trying to make, trying to ensure that teaching is an attractive profession. One way we're doing that, for example, is ensuring that teachers in Scotland are the best paid in the UK in terms of starting salary being the most attractive in the UK. We also have a number of bursaries that we're also providing for STEM subjects, but also for those teachers that do are willing to complete the probation anywhere in Scotland. There is the preference waiver scheme, which means that teachers can receive up to £8,000 if they are willing, as I say, to complete the probation anywhere in Scotland. We're also working with stakeholders on a joint campaign to encourage people to consider teaching as an attractive profession. So there are a range of issues that we're working on, and again, more than happy for the Education Secretary to write to Jamie Green with further detail of the actions that we are taking.
Question number 6, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the First Minister what urgent action is being taken to address long waits in A&E departments in light of reports that over 7,300 patients waited for more than a day in 2023, with some waiting much longer.
First Minister.
I do want to emphasise that all long waits are, of course, unacceptable. We continue to work hard with health boards to reduce delays for patients. A&E performance is impacted by pressures from right across the wider health and social care system, which is why our unscheduled care collaborative programme is taking a very whole systems approach as we work with health boards in delivering sustained improvement. Through this programme, a whole range of actions are being taken to improve patient flows to reduce A&E delays. These include actions to strengthen arrangements to avoid unnecessary hospital admissions, such as same-day emergency care services, expanding our hospital-at-home services, and optimising flow navigation centres, and supporting patients to ensure that they receive the right care in the right place, and trying to reduce the pressure on our very busy acute sites.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I thank the First Minister for his response? But in Esher and Arran, one patient waited at A&E for 122 hours. That's 5 days. At Borders General, it was 88 hours. In NHS Lanarkshire, someone waited over 72 hours. Consultants tell me, consultants, that patients are being treated on trolleys, in corridors, when they should be in a bed. And let's be in no doubt, these long waits are costing lives. First Minister, don't take my word for it. The Royal College of Emergency Medicine estimate that there were up to 2,000 excess deaths last year caused by patients waiting over eight hours, in emergency departments. That, frankly, is a national scandal. So can the First Minister explain what action will be taken now to tackle long waits at A&E departments before more lives are lost?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm not disputing with neither Jackie Bailey nor the Royal College of Emergency Medicine that there is undoubtedly a relationship between long waits and increased risk of harm, which is why we are absolutely committed to reducing those waits. I would say that some of the figures that were presented in the FOI were erroneous, not due to anything that Jackie Bailey has said, but I believe due to some coding or recording errors. Nonetheless, Jackie Bailey's point remains and remains correct, that there are still people exceptionally, not the rule, but exceptionally, that are waiting far, far too long to be seen in A&E. Jackie Bailey asked what action will be taken. Again, happy for the Health Secretary to write in greater detail, but I can give you some of the actions that we are taking. We are, for example, increasing and bolstering our support for NHS 24, and we know by doing so that that could stop and reduce the numbers that are then going to A&E. In fact, we've increased staffing levels by 65% since 2007. Of course, NHS 24 is now a 24/7 service. We're also increasing and expanding hospital at home in this winter, provided 455 beds leading into the winter to enable more people to get treatment from home. We're also increasing staffing levels as well in terms of A&E workforce. We're recruiting more and more A&E consultants to help again with that flow. There's been a 300% increase, in fact, in A&E consultants under the SNP. And the last thing, or not the last thing, but certainly one of the other things I would draw Jackie Bailey's attention to, is that we're looking to support social care because we know how important that is to deal with the delayed discharge issue. And of course, in a few weeks' time, those working in social care will get a further pay
briefly, First Minister.
Of £12 an hour.
Thank you. Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. Declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. First Minister, as a GP, I see people who cannot wait any longer in that A&E queue. They come to me with chest pain. They come to me with signs of stroke. They come to me because they don't even want to get into that queue. And that puts huge pressure on me in GP and on primary care. So what can you do for us in primary care to ensure that we can deal with these patients?
First Minister.
Can I thank Dr. Gulhani for the work that he does as a GP and, of course, other GPs right across the country. We are, of course, seeking to improve any performance that has been affected and impacted undoubtedly by the global pandemic. That is a pressure that is faced by A&E services right across the UK, and it's why, of course, we continue to seek to improve that A&E performance. And Scotland's A&E departments are the best performing, we know, in the UK and have been for 8 years. In terms of the support we're providing, what we're looking to do is make sure that we can take some pressure away from, be it busy acute sites or indeed, we know, very busy primary care sites as well. That's why we're investing in NHS 24. It's why we're investing at hospital at home as well. It's why we're investing in, for example, increasing the staffing levels. And of course, we have a target to increase the headcount number of GPs and, of course, have continued to make progress in that regard.
Thank you. We move to constituency and general supplementaries. I call Ben McPherson.
Presiding Officer, Parliament will be aware of the concerning fire on Breadalbane Street in my constituency, where combustible cladding may have been a factor. Does the First Minister share my empathy for all those affected and my gratitude to the many firefighters and other emergency service personnel who have responded? And does the First Minister agree with me that this very worrying incident emphasises the importance of high-rise firefighting capability in urban areas and the extra funding for the fire service in the budget, and that it is vital that the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill and the Cladding Remediation Programme are taken forward with urgency by Parliament, Government and developers?
First Minister.
Yes, I agree with all of that from Ben McPherson. Can I also add my thanks to the emergency services, in particular Scottish Fire and Rescue, for their efforts. And of course, those efforts saw everybody, I think including Graham Simpson, who was there as well, evacuated safely and without injury. So I'm very pleased to see that. Can I say that we know this is still an evolving situation? Ben McPherson is, of course, right. It is important that we continue to fund the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and that's why we've seen an increase in the budget for 24-25. But I also think what Ben McPherson says around cladding is incredibly important, and incredibly important that the bill that we've seen make some progress just this week, of course, continues to make progress, and all of the stakeholders who have responsibility for cladding and remediation take those responsibilities seriously. They don't have to wait for the bill in order to take action.
Douglas Lumsden.
Presiding Officer, it is 2 years since we lost our friend and colleague David Hill while playing for the parliamentary rugby team in Dublin. His parents Sharon and Roger have been an inspiration. David's father Roger is currently on an epic cycle journey to deliver the match ball for the annual match between the Scottish and Irish parliaments, but also to raise funds and awareness for cardiac risk in the young. Roger has been joined by friends and family for parts of the journey and was even joined by yourself, Presiding Officer, as he left Edinburgh. So will the First Minister join me in wishing all those involved the very best of wishes and also pledge to look at any ways that his government can introduce screening to improve outcomes for those living with an undetected cardiac condition?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I do join with Douglas Lumsden in congratulating Sharon and Roger. I've had the pleasure of meeting them on a couple of occasions when they were most recently at Parliament. And they are incredible. I think anybody, I can't think of a worse loss than losing a child, and nobody would begrudge Sharon and Roger if they just dealt privately with that grief. But what they've chosen to do instead, in David's memory, is to ensure that they raise awareness of undetected cardiac issues in the young and cardiac risk in the young. And for that, they absolutely deserve not just recognition, but I think they have the admiration of everybody right across this Parliament. I wish Roger well, certainly in the cycle that he is doing. And of course, I will pledge to look at what further we can do, possibly in relation to screening and those who have undetected cardiac issues. And I'm more than happy for the Health Secretary to engage directly with Douglas Lumsden, and I'm sure he will also engage with Sharon and indeed Roger on these issues.
Paul Sweeney.
Tomorrow, the Strathclyde Partnership for Transport Board is set to approve bus franchising as part of their regional bus strategy, but the Scottish Government has cut SPT's capital budget for the coming year to zero. This cut will hamper SPT's ability to take our buses back under public control and deliver a better bus service for all of Greater Glasgow. So does the First Minister welcome the bus franchise for Greater Glasgow? And if so, will he make sure that SPT has the funding necessary to ensure that it can be launched as soon as possible?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, of course, it is under legislation that was brought forward by this SNP government that that bus franchising is possible. So we're very pleased that we have been able to enable that to take place at a local level. In terms of our funding for local government, can I remind the member, of course, that we're giving an increase in budget to our local authorities, and we're always happy to continue to engage with our local authorities, with their partners such as SPT, to see what more we can do in order to ensure that our public services, our public transport, is as accessible and affordable as possible. And my colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, will be bringing a debate forward to this Parliament in relation to the Fair Fares Review, which I believe will be debated with the agreement of Parliament without motion, to have that really good discussion, I hope, on what further we can do in order to ensure that public transport, be it buses, be it railways, or indeed any other form of public transport, is as accessible and affordable as possible.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Does the First Minister share my extreme disappointment that Scotland will not be included in the UK Government's Horizon legislation announced this week? And can he outline the steps the Scottish Government is taking to right the injustice imposed on those living in Scotland and who were profoundly affected by the Post Office Horizon scandal?
First Minister.
I do absolutely share that sentiment from Audrey Nicholl. The Deputy First Minister has written to the UK Government to urge them to excuse me, reconsider their decision, as has the First Minister and Deputy First Minister of Northern Ireland. There is a real frustration. We, of course, stated very publicly our preference for that legislation to apply UK-wide. It would have been the fairest way, the most equitable way, to ensure fair treatment for sub-postmasters and mistresses in Scotland, as well as right across the UK. The concern now is that, of course, we will bring forward Scottish-specific legislation if the UK Government don't change their position. But, of course, that Scottish legislation would have to align with UK legislation, and that UK legislation is going to have to make its way through the UK Parliament. It will undoubtedly be amended through the various stages of that parliamentary process, and that will inevitably then have an impact on our ability to introduce legislation. And we hope that won't have an impact, of course, on Scottish sub-postmasters and mistresses being able to access that UK-wide compensation and payment that they are overdue. So we will bring forward Scottish-specific legislation, but I would once again urge the UK Government to treat sub-postmasters and mistresses in Scotland the same as they are treating sub-postmasters and mistresses in England and Wales.
Annie Wells.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, I recently met with a constituent of mine in Glasgow called Michaela Hola, who told me about the serious concerns she has for her autistic son and non-verbal son Logan. At 5 years old, he is due to start school in August. It's quite clear that due to his development delay and other challenges relating to autism, he will be unable to cope in a mainstream school. The paediatricians, neurologists and other medical professionals who know Logan agree. However, Glasgow City Council have declared that no alternatives are available to Logan and he must start school, mainstream school, later this year, and there is no route for appeal to contest this. It's a totally unacceptable situation which risks harming Logan and causing his family considerable anxiety. Can I ask that the First Minister works with me to look again at this case to see if a more suitable alternative for this vulnerable young boy can be found?
First Minister.
Well, again, of course, I'm more than happy for Annie Wells to furnish me and the government with the detail of Logan's case, with Logan's mother's, Michaela's, permission. And if she does, then, of course, we'll happily consult with the local authority. But these are decisions that are made locally. But also, it is important that we take on board the expert clinical opinion of those locally. And that's where the issue is perhaps concerning, because Annie Wells is suggesting from her question that those clinical opinions are not being taken into account. So if Annie Wells could furnish me and the government with the details of Logan's case, with permission from Michaela, then of course we will look into that and see if we can be of any assistance whatsoever.
And Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. March is Brain Tumour Awareness Month, and can I thank the First Minister for agreeing to join in the Brain Tumour Research Wear a Hat Day photo call immediately after MFQs, and I hope all MSPs here will be able to join us too. Brain tumours kill more children and adults under the age of 40 than any other cancer. Despite this devastating impact, this area of cancer research is underfunded. With over 150 different types of brain tumour, what can the First Minister say about increasing funding to find improved treatments and ultimately find cures?
First Minister.
Can I thank Beatrice Wishart for all of her efforts in this regard, and I look forward to the photo call just shortly after First Minister's questions. Let me also put on record my thanks to all of those who do seek to use their own experiences to speak out about brain tumours and the need to be cautious and conscious of raising awareness of any getting support where necessary and where needed. And I think of the case of Glenn Campbell, particularly BBC journalist well known right across the chamber, who has used his experience and his voice to raise awareness of brain tumours. Can I also say to Beatrice Wishart, again, I'm more than happy for the Health Secretary to write her with further details, but we are increasing funding to the NHS this year, over £19.5 billion worth of funding to the NHS, record funding to the NHS, and I know just how seriously tackling all cancers, including, of course, tackling neurological cancers, brain cancer, is to our NHS colleagues right across the country.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Karen Adam, and there will now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and public gallery to do so before the debate begins.